So there have been two papers that dealt with two animals that have very similar behaviors in the modern day, and they actually both evolved around the same time. That said, though, they're almost as far apart evolutionarily as you can be while still being vertebrates on land. And that's because one's a mammal and one's a bird. So the first paper we're going to look at is the one on the mammals, which it's about bats specifically. And bats are kind of an evolutionary enigma because they kind of show up out of nowhere. Even the earliest bat fossils we have had up until this paper already show bats that are very, very well developed. Animals like Onychonycterus and Paleocheiropteryx from the Green River Formation and Messel Pit, respectively, are already very clearly bats. They already have well-developed wings and long, spindly fingers to help support those wings. But because of genetic studies, we can actually say that their closest relatives are probably both the ungulates, so a lot of the hoofed animals, and the carnivorans, which both split off from each other relatively near around the same time. So essentially, the bats were just one lineage that split off slightly before that, and then the other two split from each other. And that means that the problem really is in those fossils, because the earliest bat we have, Onychonycterus, is actually from 52 million years ago, and then the next one is from 48 million years ago. But like I mentioned, this is the Green River Formation for the first one, coming from North America, and then the Messel Pit in Germany. So they had to travel almost 10,000 miles, almost entirely around the globe, within just those 4 million years. And sure, they can fly, but that's still a very short time frame. But now there's a new fossil of a bat coming from China, and helps indicate that they were already a part of at least Central Asian faunas even before the Green River Formation or the Messel Pit were deposited, because it is older than either of those fossils. Now, the age of this rock is actually based on the other fossils in it because they're very indicative of a very, very early Eocene time period, rather than using specific isotopes to do radiometric dating. But this is something that's very regularly used in paleontology, and it's essentially just called biostratigraphy, trying to estimate the age of rocks without needing to do expensive tests on specific minerals that might be in those rocks. Unfortunately for this fossil, though, it's not nearly as well preserved because this formation was not a lagerstätten. And lagerstätten is just a fancy term that means there's really, really good fossil preservation. So things like the Messel Pit in Germany, the Green River Formation in the United States, or even some of the other formations in Germany, such as the Solnhofen limestone from which Archaeopteryx is known. This fossil is essentially just a tooth in a jaw, but that's still super useful because in mammals, the teeth are so unique per group that it's still very important to try and recognize what teeth it had so that we can identify what group it was from. Whereas in dinosaurs and other animals that had more regularized teeth among the entire jaw and within multiple groups, it's a lot harder to try and narrow down which group it may have been. So that means that we can tell that this is indeed a bat. And in fact, we can tell from some of the morphologies on these teeth that it is its own genus. It's named Altainecteris, and it helps to show that the bats didn't necessarily have to migrate 10,000 miles all at once. Instead, they may have had to just migrate 5,000 miles one direction and 5,000 miles the other direction. So a much easier kind of transportation to try and make in just a few million years, rather than trying to cross the entire globe. It also means that we probably want to look for the oldest bat fossils in parts of Central Asia, rather than looking in areas like the Green River Formation, where we had previously thought it would be better to look based on other fossils like Onychonycterus. So it is super useful to have this fossil so that we can try and find more. However, there's a lot that's been going on geologically in Central Asia that means we may not find these fossils. Specifically, the rise of the Himalayas may have completely buried these fossils. They could be thousands of meters underground, or even worse yet, completely destroyed by those tectonic forces. So we may not have those fossils, although they could still hypothetically exist. And the only way to really get out there and know is to have people get out into the field and start looking. I already teased at the beginning of this video, though, that there was another paper that talked about a similar animal. And this one wasn't a mammal, it was a bird. And it actually comes from the same time period, meaning essentially this niche was very open during the early Eocene. This one, though, comes from England. Named Archaeodromius anglicus, this animal was related to nightjars. And nightjars have a lot of different forms today, including things that are like the frogmouth or the putu. They're very strange-looking birds in general. But they have a very wide mouth, which is super useful for catching bugs that are flying around at night. And they do that just like bats do. This fossil has been named a new species because the quadrate bone specifically in the jaw has a kind of upturned cup-shaped feature, which is completely unique. We don't see this in any other birds. But the quadrate also has a lot of different projections that are in the same place as the projections on the quadrates of modern nightjars. And a lot of these are super specific, such as the capitulum auticum. So these are very specific names given to specific projections. And with that in mind, they were able to actually run the phylogenetic analysis and found that Archaeodromius and a few other early potential nightjars were actually not quite nightjars, but sister taxon to them. which essentially means they're very closely related to the lineage that did lead to true nightjars, or at least modern nightjars. So with this fossil of an early nightjar and the bat fossils I mentioned earlier, it really goes to show that only 10 million years after the extinction that killed off the dinosaurs, many animals were already starting to fill specific niches, including some niches that they still fill to this day. And that's not because this was a totally new niche. In fact, during the Cretaceous, there was a group of pterosaurs called the Eneognathids, and they actually died out about 55 million years before the impact, but they were very similar, having wide mouths and large eyes and probably flying around at night to catch bugs. So this means for that last 55 million years or so of the Cretaceous, this niche was still available and animals just weren't filling it, potentially because there weren't any animals that could fill it. There may not have been any animals that could fly well enough to fill it. However, once that extinction did happen and different mammal groups and different bird groups started to radiate, some of them started to develop abilities that would let them start filling these niches. And the fact that it happened already only 10 million years after the extinction helps to show how quickly radiation events can occur immediately after large extinction events. But while these radiations happened at around the same time, the bats had more success early on because they had much better ranges. However, that might be somewhat biased because the birds have very light bones that are less likely to fossilize. However, bats also fly and have relatively light bones, so I'm not entirely sure how good of an argument that is. Instead, it just seems like the bats did honestly do better early on. They were able to spread across the continents faster. And that's not to say anything against the nightjars. Like the bats, they occupy all the continents except Antarctica in the modern day. They just had a little bit of a slower start. And both of them have been wildly, wildly successful in their very similar but slightly different niches, as they are competing against one another and need slight differences to become successful.